automatically. Okay. So thank you very much. Thanks for the invitation. Thanks everybody for coming. So I planned to start off showing you a few slides, but I haven't figured out how to project them there. So I'll just describe to you what's on there. And you have seen all of those slides before. So the first slide I wanted to show you is basically this beautiful image that we have of fluctuations in the cosmic microwave background. Okay, one of the most beautiful images ever produced. Okay, and so what I wanted to point out is that if you just think about these fluctuations for just a second, you immediately run into trouble with this map. Okay, so if you believe in the standard Big Bang picture of a slowly decelerating but expanding space-time, these fluctuations in the map make little sense. Okay, they seem to violate causality in a way that I'm going to show you very briefly in a moment. Okay. In fact, there's a second problem. It's not just that these fluctuations. So the first problem is that these fluctuations are very tiny over a large region on the sky. But more than that, the fluctuations aren't just random noise. Okay. So even if there was some miracle that set up these achieved that the universe is almost precisely homogeneous, now you're seeing these fluctuations on top of a homogeneous background, and it's not just random noise, but it has correlations over large angular scales. Okay. So there are two stages to the problem. The first is kind of the old horizon problem, where it's hard to explain why it should be homogeneous and isotropic in the first place. But then you're seeing those fluctuations, and you see that those fluctuations themselves are correlated over large scales, which is kind of a new version of the horizon problem. Okay? The first one you could have come up with even without looking at the sky. Just very broad features of the universe seem to require something beyond the standard Big Bang picture. But then in more detail, when you actually look at the fluctuations, you see that they're correlated over large scales. Okay. So the plan of my lectures is going to be basically three parts. So in the first part, I'm going to review very briefly basic notions of inflation. And so my hope is that you have seen all of this before. Okay. But I'm going to give you the absolute theoretical minimum. Okay. That I think any self-respecting theoretical physicist should have seen those things. And I hope you have seen those before, but I might highlight a few things that you might not have thought about this way. Okay, so I'm going to sacrifice the first lecture, hopefully telling you known things. Okay, I'm going to cheat a little bit because I'm also giving a lecture colloquium on Wednesday afternoon. So I actually have 5 lectures, and so in that colloquium I will tell you some extra stuff if you don't go skiing. Okay, so that's the first part that's going to cover today. I'm going to basically tell you enough to understand all the results from the Planck satellite that's going to come out tonight. Okay, I should highlight this. Tonight and on Thursday. This course is perfectly planned. Okay, I spoke with the Planck people and told them, I'm giving these lectures. Could they please give new data? And so they're going to do this tonight. In fact, tonight is going to be the famous Planck bicep paper that's coming out. On Thursday, then they're putting out all the papers. So I'm going to show you, in fact, I'm going to show you some plots of bicep and so on that if you're not Facebook friends with the right people, you haven't seen before. And so I'm going to show you those things tomorrow. Anyway, so I want to start off just telling you enough so that you can appreciate what this data really means. Oh, yeah, and I should also say, so I made a very little website for this course, which is also linked to on the official website for this school. So if you go there, you can download right now already, in fact, these lecture notes. So especially people in the back who can't see very well this should get a laptop and download these things. And everybody else should kind of move closer so you can read my writing, okay? But basically, everything I'm going to write on the board is going to be in these notes, and they're online right now already. Okay, so let me start off with the horizon problem. And describe it in the way that I find most transparent. Yeah? And so the horizon problem basically is a conflict between the homogeneity we observe in the universe and the particle horizon in the standard Big Bang cosmology. Okay? So first of all, homogeneity. And also isotropy you know, fix the form of the space-time metric in a rather specific way. So this implies the famous FRW metric. So if you have studied any cosmology before, this is the very first thing that everybody will do. So the four-dimensional metric of space-time under these assumptions of homogeneity and isotropy collapses to just a single function of time. And so this function of time, the scale factor, parameterizes the expansion of spatial slices. And so for simplicity, I have assumed flat spatial slices here. But in principle, you could also have curvature, homogeneous curvature on these three-dimensional slices. Where this scale factor here is determined by the Einstein equation and will depend on the matter content of the universe. So for example, if the universe is filled with matter without any pressure, then this scale factor goes as T^2/3. If it's filled with radiation or relativistic particles, then it goes as T^1/2. Okay? And things with a positive equation of state anywhere in between will have some intermediate power law scaling with the scale factor. Okay? So this is the FRW metric. The question is, how did this FRW metric arise in the first place? Okay? And the reason it's puzzling is if you compute the particle horizon in such a space-time, at a certain time t, you find the following expression. So the physical particle horizon at time t is equal to the scale factor at that time times an integral from some initial time, which I'm going to define to be the singularity at time equals t equals 0, to some final time t. Dt over A of t. Okay? And so effectively, this is an integral over conformal time. And so if you transform this metric to conformal time, then light rays, of course, will famously travel on 45 degrees. And then distance and time scales are equal. And so here I'm just the maximal distance that light can travel from time 0 to time t is just an integral over conformal time in that time period. And then rescaled by the scale factor to go to physical coordinates. Okay. So then immediately you can also, it's convenient to rewrite this particle horizon as an integral over the scale factor from 0 to a d log a over a dot. Okay. So I can do a change of variables to go from time to scale factor. And so I see that I'm integrating, having a logarithmic integral. So this is basically an integral over the number of e foldings of expansion divided by a dot. Okay. The A dot is basically the Jacobian, and going from here to here. But then you see immediately that this expression, especially for these two matter components in the universe, this expression actually converges in the past. Okay? So which converges to a finite radius in particular, it converges if the second time derivative of the scale factor is negative and the space-time is decelerating. Okay? Because then this integral will be dominated by late times, and there will be very little contribution to this integral from early times. Okay? And so, in particular, for these, you can actually compute this integral for these two special cases, and what you would find is that the physical horizon is equal to 3 times the physical time coordinate if the universe is matter dominated, or 2 times the time coordinate if the universe is filled with radiation. Okay? And in particular, this is a rather small value if you haven't had enough time for light to propagate over a large distance. Okay? And so this implies And I'm going to show you with a space-time diagram in a moment why that's the case. So this implies that the CMB, or cosmic microwave background, consists of many spatially disconnected or causally disconnected patches of space. Okay, so how do we see this? Actually, I won't need this. So imagine I draw a space-time diagram where I'm drawing time on the vertical axis. And so here, as a notion of time, I'm going to use the scale factor itself. So in fact, and the scale factor today, I'm going to normalize to be 1. Then we will have the singularity at the scale factor equals to 0 at some time in the past. And then the CMB was created when the scale factor, and this moment is often called recombination, when this scale factor was of order 10 to the minus 3. Okay. Can people in the back still see this, or is it tough? Tough. I'll try to. So you can calculate this because you can calculate the temperature at which neutral atoms will form, and so you basically can extrapolate backwards, through a period where we know the matter content of the universe very well. So we know it today, and we know it into the past until this moment. So this is when the CMB was created, the universe became neutral. So we have a spatial time slice at recombination. And today, when we're looking at the CMB, so we're observers living here. So we're observing things on our past light cone. Okay. So in this diagram, we're observing the CMB at these two points. Okay, because light travels at 45 degrees in this diagram. So CMB photons will travel along those lines. Photons coming from here, incidentally, would have reached us in the past. Photons coming from here will reach us in the future. So since I've suppressed two space dimensions, the CMB is collapsed to just two opposite points in the sky. If you imagine an S1 around this, this would be a circle in the sky. And then the remaining S2 gives us the surface of last scattering. But these are the kind of the two polar opposite points where the horizon problem becomes most dramatic. And so the horizon problem is the feature that these two points have their own past light cones. So that's the sphere of influence of this point here. So outside of that region, there's no communication between patches of space here and patches of this point in space, and similarly here. But these two light cones only extend onto the singularity and therefore have no time for causal contact. Okay? So these two points, P and Q, if you want to think about this with one dimension more, you can draw the surface of last scattering. The observer is sitting here. This is the point Q. This is the point P. There's a finite horizon size around these two points. Okay? And so you can see that even points that are not separated as dramatically as P and Q, but anything separated by more than 1 degree has passed light cones that wouldn't have overlapped in the entire history of the universe. Okay? So that's the causality or horizon problem of the standard Big Bang cosmology. The problem basically is that in the standard Big Bang cosmology, there's a finite amount of conformal time elapsed between the singularity and recombination, which is smaller than the amount of conformal time between recombination and today. Okay? And so what you have to do in order to solve this is reverse this inequality. You have to somehow create more conformal time or more particle horizon before recombination than there was afterwards from recombination until today. Okay? Any questions about this? This is famously often misunderstood, I think. So it's no shame to, even when I thought I understood it, I realized I had misconceptions about this. So.
Sorry.
Yeah. Oh.
Here, I have a question.
Yeah.
So why is causal contact necessary for homogeneity? Because people in statistical mechanics would probably not agree on this.
Usually we are less surprised if things are equal, if they have been in thermal contact and have reached thermal equilibrium, and we didn't have to impose some initial condition that looks unnatural. Okay? But this horizon problem, in fact, and I should emphasize this, is not a strict inconsistency. There's nothing going wrong. If I set up the universe in this particular way, yeah, homogeneous and isotropic, and then evolve it forward in time, then nothing bad happens. It's just if you had an alternative, I think the point is if you have no alternative, then there's nothing to complain about. If you had a dynamical mechanism that achieves homogeneity and isotropy from a more generic set of initial conditions, you might favor this. Okay? And in fact, for me, in fact, homogeneity and isotropy, you might even appeal to some deep wave function of the universe, blah, blah, blah. Okay, it's a very symmetric state, so maybe it is a preferred set of initial conditions. But then I think you still have to address the second version of the horizon problem, that how did you create these weakly coupled fluctuations that are correlated and not just random noise over these large scales. So that's, in fact, I think the more observationally relevant version of the horizon problem to focus on. Okay, anything else? Okay, maybe another thing to say, since you didn't ask, okay, you could also complain that, strictly speaking, since I've extended this calculation of the particle horizon back to the singularity, okay, but strictly speaking, of course, my integral will get contributions from moments very close to singularity where my space-time description has broken down. So if you were, you know, if you did not want to concede that the standard Big Bang theory has a horizon problem, you could appeal to this fact that I don't know how much conformal time or how much physical horizon distance was created during that first moment when the space-time description was breaking down. Okay, so there was an implicit assumption that we were assuming that this contribution to the integral is small. Okay, but you could appeal to some quantum gravity hocus pocus in that regime that actually achieved correlations over large distances. But then you don't have a theory, and then again you should explain why out of that quantum gravity regime you were emerging with correlated fluctuations and weakly coupled and those things. Okay. Okay, so the fundamental reason we had this finite particle horizon was the fact that we were assuming a monotonically decreasing second derivative of the scale factor. So the obvious solution to this is simply to conjecture that there was a phase where the second derivative of the scale factor, in fact, was positive. Okay? So if that's the case, then our previous expression for the particle horizon, in fact, will now get most of its contributions from early times. It will, in fact, diverge if this phase here is long enough. So the particle horizon diverges in the past. Even if it doesn't diverge, it gets a very large contribution from the lower limit of the integral. And so we can redo this space-time diagram that I was just drawing. So now we extend conformal time or the physical particle horizon distance into the past. So what appeared to be the singularity in the past was actually just a transition from a phase that had a double dot greater than zero, so here, to a phase that had a double dot smaller than zero. And so then these two points, P and Q, that I had previously, now have light cones that extend further into the past. And there will be causal contact between them. At some sufficiently early moment in time. So if I can have this period of inflation last long enough, I'm pushing effectively the singularity far enough into the conformal past, okay, so that the space-time diagram gets extended far enough into the past and causal structure is established at early times, or can be established at early times. Okay? Okay, so I hope you have seen all of this before. But you should feel free to ask me questions later on about this. So, of course, this is a very simple hypothesis you can make. It's just simply stating something about the dynamics of this FRW evolution. The question arises, how do we achieve something like this? So how does A double dot greater than zero occur? So first, let me point out that A double dot greater than zero is equivalent to a slowly evolving Hubble rate. And here, what I mean by slowly evolving Hubble rate is I mean that the first time derivative of the Hubble constant, and so remember that the Hubble constant is A dot over A, okay? So you can simply, it's just algebra to show that A double dot greater than zero corresponds to A dot over H squared less than 1. Okay? And of course, in the limit where epsilon is 0, the Hubble rate is constant. That just corresponds to a constant expansion sourced by a constant vacuum energy. So the perfect inflationary limit would be just the Sitter space. So if epsilon is equal to zero, we are in the Sitter space. This is actually not what we want, because in the Sitter space, we have perfect time translation invariance. And so we cannot talk about cosmology. And any time slice in the Sitter space is equivalent to any other time slice. So we really do want a breaking of the Sitter symmetries. We want this epsilon parameter to be finite. So what we essentially want is we want the Sitter with a clock. So some set of matter fields that have time-dependent expectation values that introduce a preferred time slicing into the Sitter space that then allows me to measure time in a quasi-de Sitter background. Okay? So we're close enough to the Sitter that we can often impart a lot of results that apply to the Sitter space, like mode functions of fields in the Sitter space and things like that will hold approximately. But it's essential that we're not in perfect de Sitter space such that we have a well-defined end to inflation, that we measure time appropriately. Okay? So the essential idea basically just is, if we think of the Sitter space as just a positive cosmological constant, all fields have fixed vacuum expectation value with fixed energy density, then the simple idea of inflation is just to have an approximate de Sitter space where at least one of these fields is given a time-dependent expectation value. Okay? And so this is often what we call the inflaton field. And so if that inflaton field has a time-dependent expectation value, we can use it as the clock. It will tell us how inflation proceeds. And in particular, it will also tell us how we exit from this phase. Sorry?
Sorry? Is it efficient for all finite potential to a curve on?
You mean what happens far away from this point? Or?
No, this is an addition.
Yes?
That you mentioned, yeah.
I'm just saying something very simple that, we know that the Sitter space is sourced by a positive constant vacuum energy density. Now I'm tilting this, and I get a time-dependent energy density, and that time-dependent energy density is what's sourcing inflation. Okay, so rather than just giving you this cartoon, let me just remind you of you know, the most basic toy model that tries to describe this inflationary period. So let's consider the action for a scalar field that's minimally coupled to gravity. So we have a standard Einstein-Hilbert product, a kinetic term for the field, and then a potential. It's this potential that will provide a force on the field and will describe the equation of motion for this scalar field. So I'll leave it as you, for you as an exercise, although I'm sure you have all done this in kindergarten, which is to derive the stress tensor for a scalar field in this context, T mu nu, and then compute the stress tensor in a homogeneous background where the scalar field only depends on time. When you do this, you find that the 0,0 component, which describes the energy density, is the sum of kinetic energy density and potential energy density, while the spatial part of the stress tensor is the difference. Between the two energy components. Okay. So you find that the stress tensor of a scalar field can be described by in a perfect fluid form with energy density and pressure. This can then be fed into the Einstein equations. So the first Einstein equation, which is also called the Friedmann equation, tells you how the Hubble rate is determined by the energy density of the field. So this is just 1/2 phi dot squared plus v. Okay. So energy density associated with the scalar field is driving the expansion rate. And then there's a second equation which describes the rate of change of this Hubble parameter in terms of there's a factor of 1/2. So h dot is proportional to the sum of the energy density and the pressure. And so therefore, the potential contribution cancels in the evolution of the Hubble rate. And so it only depends on kinetic energy. So it ends up being minus 1/2 phi dot squared. Okay. So it better had to work this way because we already said that for a constant vacuum energy or a constant field value, we should get the Sitter space back. So we should get 0 on the left-hand side, 0, and 0 on the right-hand side. But this form of the equations is convenient because it immediately allows me to compute this ratio epsilon, so minus h dot over h squared, as just the ratio of these two equations. And so we find that this parameter here is given by 1/2 phi dot squared divided by essentially the total energy density and Planck squared h squared. Okay. Maybe I missed a factor of 3. Okay, you can check. Okay. So requiring that this is less than 1, and often for successful inflation, in fact, we require it to be much less than 1 because you want to get scale invariant fluctuations and things like that. So having this much less than 1 means that the kinetic energy has to be much less than the total energy. And so this is what we call slow roll. Okay. So this is the first condition. We want to have a phase where for a sufficiently long period of time, the kinetic energy is small relative to the total energy. And then the second condition is that indeed we want this phase to last long enough. So we don't just want to have inflation for an instant and then immediately go over to a regular FRW expansion. So we want this to last long enough so that our light cones are extended into the past long enough. So this leads to a second condition on the dynamics. So the question is, how do we make sure that inflation lasts? So for that, we consider the Klein-Gordon equation that describes the equation of motion for the scalar field. So the second time derivative of the scalar field plus a friction term plus a force coming from the gradient equal to zero. So this will tell us how, you know, the rate of change, phi double dot, of the kinetic energy density. So we want this to be sufficiently small to maintain this low rho condition. So we require that this friction term dominates over the acceleration of the field. Okay, so maybe I should have labeled the previous condition that epsilon was less than 1 is condition number 1. The condition that the acceleration also stays small for a sufficient amount of time is condition number 2. And then I leave it to you as an exercise to show that these two conditions, 1 and 2, are satisfied if the following conditions hold on the shape of the potential. So there's a parameter epsilon, which is approximately equal to the previous epsilon in this Slerolle regime, but not exactly the same. So this parameterizes the first derivative of the potential with respect to its height. This has to be less than 1. And in addition to that, a parameter eta, which is the second derivative of the potential with respect to its height, also has to be less than 1. Okay. So these are the famous Slerolle conditions that allow you, if somebody handed you a potential of a given shape, you could determine these two parameters, and it would tell you that if I put the field there with zero velocity to begin with, then it would be inflated. It would lead to an inflating solution in the regime of the potential field space that satisfies these two conditions. Okay. But it's useful to have in mind that these were consequences of making already approximations that where this is the case. And so, in fact, the more general condition for inflation was that h dot, you know, is much less than h squared. And so you could imagine other dynamical theories that lead to that kind of solution, which also allow inflation, but which don't satisfy these conditions. Okay, so these were more general. There's a more general set of inflationary solutions that you can get even away from this low-roll regime. Okay, any questions?
So if you start on the exactly flat de Sitter potential, but with a non-zero scalar field velocity, then you also have exactly de Sitter space, but the slow roll parameter can be arbitrarily large, right?
Sorry, why is it arbitrarily large? Because so it's still phi dot over h, and so h is constant during de Sitter space. It's just h dot that is zero.
Yeah.
So there's a kinetic energy of the field that you could divide by the total vacuum energy of that de Sitter space. Yeah. So I'm not quite sure what you have in mind, but.
So you could, by making phi dot very large.
Yeah.
You could, so your epsilon is like phi dot over phi dot plus v, something like this. And so you could make that large on an exactly flat potential by, say, canceling.
I think it's hard to keep that consistent with kind of the Einstein equations, because if the field has a large amount of kinetic energy, it contributes to the stress tensor of the space-time. And so by definition, almost then, the space wouldn't be the Sitter space Yeah. It only would be, you know, you could approximately think of it that maybe as long as the kinetic energy of the field is small, it makes a very small contribution to the total, and then it doesn't source much of the expansion rate. So it will induce some kind of evolution, but maybe very tiny to the vacuum energy. Okay. But as soon as you go to the limit where it's actually the dominant contribution to the energy density, but then by definition you're not in the de Sitter limit. Yeah.
Wouldn't you say that Hubble friction slows it down anyway?
I would say so. Yeah, so it's hard to keep this alive if you just put something, you know, and give it a kick on a flat potential. Then Hubble friction would make it stop very quickly. But it's an important point about initial conditions. In fact, that these conditions, they only tell you about inflation on a potential landscape. Yeah, if you put the field there with zero velocity. So sometimes the initial conditions problem, if that region of field space is very small and the potential is actually very steep away from that region, if you put the field, in fact, you know, in that steep region, then it will get to that flat plateau region with a large kinetic energy, and you have to ask whether Hubble friction is enough to slow it down enough so that inflation actually occurs. Although naively, you know, the slow roll conditions are satisfied there, but you might overshoot. Okay. So my hope really is that this was very basic for everybody. And so that's why I went through this rather quickly. And so I'm going to slowly pick up and talk about you know, slightly more technical aspects of inflation. So the first thing, however, I want to show you is still something that I'm sure many of you have seen before. And so it's this famous calculation of quantum fluctuations in a quasi-de Sitter background. And I think it's important enough to actually have seen it 2-3 times, to do it yourself. In fact, Maldacena kept telling me, you have to be able to do this in your sleep. If somebody wakes you up, you have to be able to do this calculation. So whoever complains to me afterwards that they have seen this calculation, I'm going to wake you up tonight, and I'm going to check that you can actually do it. But if you have seen it before, maybe ask me about a couple of the subtleties that come about along the way. Okay. So the idea is, now we want to treat this scale of field phi not just classically, but also induce, you know, allow for quantum fluctuations in the field and see what kind of spatially varying density fluctuations that leads to after inflation. And that's necessary because otherwise inflation actually would be a disaster for our universe. Okay? If it wasn't for these quantum fluctuations, it would produce a universe that is completely empty after inflation, and that's precisely not what we want to arise from this phase after the singularity. So it's a very fortunate event that these quantum fluctuations exist. We can compute them, and they lead to structure that, you know, to the zeroth order approximation do look what we see. So how do we compute this? So the starting point is that during inflation, we now allow for not just the homogeneous component of the field, but also fluctuations. So I'm going to define the fluctuation of the scalar field phi as the difference between its value at a given point in space and its spatially averaged homogeneous value. Of course, I can't just, you know, it's inconsistent with the Einstein equation just to perturb the matter field, so I have to perturb the metric as well. So I do exactly the same for the metric. The metric will have spatial variations, and I'm subtracting the FRW homogeneous part of the metric. We will simplify the calculation by working in a specific gauge. Of course, you can still make coordinate transformations and you know, move fluctuations from the matter sector into the metric sector and vice versa. For example, I can do a shift in time, and this is what we're going to do right now. I can shift my time coordinate in such a way that actually my spatial slices have precisely constant field value. Okay, and so there are actually no scalar field fluctuations, and all the fluctuations have been moved into the metric sector of the theory. So this is called co-moving gauge. So we will work in co-moving gauge. And this is basically, in inflation, for this calculation, there are basically two preferred gauges. One is co-moving gauge. The other gauge would be kind of the opposite of that, which is to move most of my field fluctuations to the matter sector and choose spatial slices, which are spatially flat in the metric. That's called spatially flat gauge for obvious reasons. This is the gauge that connects more naturally to the phase after inflation. I can follow the same perturbation variable from the beginning of inflation to towards the end, while in spatially flat gauge, that gauge becomes ill-defined when the inflaton field disappears, basically. And so you have to change gauge before you continue. Although some of the quantization is easier in spatially flat gauge. So they have their advantages in depending on taste. But as I said, I'm going to work in a gauge where I'm setting the field equal to zero. And so I've used my freedom of changing time to do that definition. Then I still have a freedom of redefining my spatial coordinates on the spatial slice. And so that allows me to write the spatial metric in this particular form. 1 minus twice a special metric perturbation zeta. And so this zeta perturbation is called the scalar part of the metric fluctuation, and the zeta variable is called the co-moving curvature perturbation. Okay, this is a convenient perturbation variable to keep track of for two reasons, basically. You can prove that under very general circumstances, and precisely the circumstances that we're studying right now, it's conserved outside of the horizon. Okay, so we can quantize it on small scales, then inflation stretches it to long distances, and at those long distances, they will receive a classical variance in its correlation functions, and that classical variance is preserved until very much after inflation, when these modes come back into the horizon. And so we're immediately focusing on this one conserved mode outside of the horizon. And the second convenient thing is that when it comes back inside of the horizon, it plays the role of the gravitational potential. Okay? And it's directly related then to fluctuations in the dark matter, and we can immediately feed this fluctuation variable into our codes. Okay? So it's those two reasons that make it nice to follow this zeta variable. And then... Well, not yet. We're going to see in a moment. So far, I've just parameterized arbitrary fluctuations, quantum or classical, in both the space-time and the matter fields. Okay, we're going to quantize in a moment. First, I just have to show you what the classical equation of motion for those fluctuations are, and then show you how to quantize that field. Okay. And then in addition to this scalar variable zeta, we can have a transverse traceless tensor component whose quantization modes are the graviton. And so since we're only going to study linearized fluctuations and the power spectrum of fluctuations, in fact, at that order, these two modes exactly decouple. And so I can study them independently. I can study the quantization of scalar fluctuations independent from the quantization of these tensor modes. So for the time being, I'm going to set this tensor mode equal to zero and just study what happens to this curvature perturbation zeta. Okay? So this is how I parameterize my fluctuations in both the matter fields and the metric. You should keep in mind that in addition to the spatial part of the metric, of course, we still have the 0-0 component of the metric, which also has to be perturbed, and the off-diagonal 0i component of the metric. This is often done most conveniently in the ADM formalism, where you define non-dynamical lapse and shift parameters. And then you have Einstein equations that in fact relate, constraint equations, that relate the value of the zeta variable to the lapse and the shift in the ADM formalism. Okay? So I'm not going to show you how this works because it's tedious and boring and nothing enlightening happens by doing it. So let me just give you the final answer. What happens when you substitute all my metric fluctuations back into the inflaton action that we had at the beginning? So expanding the inflaton action to second order. And we want it to second order because we want to have linearized equation of motions, of course. So at that order, we find the following quadratic action for the zeta variable. So the determinant of the metric that was multiplying the action gives us a factor of a cubed. There's a factor of this epsilon slow roll parameter that we have during inflation that normalizes the entire action. And then we just have the kinetic term of zeta and its spatial gradients. Okay? So remember that this epsilon here was 1/2 phi dot squared divided by m Planck squared h squared. Okay? So this actually, you know, it's quite non-trivial to get to this point. And so if you go to the archive, Astro PH 0210, to this number, you will actually see this ADM calculation performed explicitly. So this is Maldacena's very famous paper, the other one. And so it's still one of the nicest places to learn about how to perform this entire calculation. Okay, and I'm just showing you snapshots of the calculation that he does in much more detail along the way. So there's a bit of a tedious step of solving the constraint equations at linear orders, plugging it back in, and getting this answer. So the one remarkable thing about this action to notice is that it doesn't have a mass term. Okay? So this zeta variable at quadratic order, in principle, a priori, of course, could have had a mass. Okay? And in fact, delta, if you were to get the same quadratic action for delta phi fluctuations, it does have a mass at order epsilon. And so this is the unique perturbation variable that doesn't have a mass term, which is precisely what achieves that it doesn't evolve outside of the horizon. Okay? Because outside of the horizon, then these gradient terms all starts vanishing. And evolution would only come from mass terms, but this mass is absent by symmetry. Okay? In fact, we can see this if you take this action. And vary it, you get the equation of motion. So something very similar to the equation of motion that we got for the scalar field earlier. So there's an acceleration of zeta, there's a friction, and then there's a gradient force. But the important point is there's no mass term to the field. And so if I go to super horizon scales, meaning I choose wavelengths that are much larger relative to the Hubble horizon, okay, then this contribution here vanishes, and a constant zeta mode will become the growing mode solution. Okay, there will be two solutions, in fact, outside of the horizon, one that's decaying rapidly with time, and another one that's just constant, which comes from just putting a constant into a solution that doesn't have this gradient term.
It's the result of variation of this action.
Yeah, you can check if you want. You should check that this three... That's good exercise, yeah. You should check that this three is that three, okay? Okay? So in fact, we can summarize the different behaviors of this mode function zeta at different times. If I draw the evolution of a single Fourier mode of zeta as a function of time, and now I'm drawing time along the horizontal axis. So first of all, during inflation, we have a nearly constant Hubble rate, and so we have a nearly constant Hubble radius. And then after inflation, so this phase here is inflation. Inflation ends, the Hubble rate starts decreasing because all the energy densities in the universe start decreasing, which means that the inverse of the Hubble rate, which determines the local causality of all field fluctuations, starts increasing. So the standard Big Bang evolution occurs afterwards. And so now in these physical coordinates, physical wavelengths of zeta are stretched to large scales. And so if they start on small scales, they will exit the horizon at a given moment in time. In fact, they will exit at the specific moment where the wave number in physical units is equal to the Hubble rate. The mode exits, then it freezes because the evolution becomes friction dominated. Okay, and then it re-enters the horizon at late times and starts evolving again inside of the horizon. Okay, so what I've plotted here is the wavelength of the mode, which is given by the scale factor divided by some fixed wave number k. And since the scale factor is increasing with time, we have this characteristic evolution where modes start. So if you go sufficiently back in time, modes will start inside of the horizon, they will exit the horizon, and then they come back into the horizon at late times. OK. I didn't check when I started. How long do I have?
Maybe 7 minutes.
7 minutes. OK. OK, so the basic idea now is that we want to start studying these fluctuations zeta at early times. And in fact, we want to calculate the quantum zero point fluctuations in the field at early times. Then we use the equation of motion to evolve those zero-point fluctuations to horizon exit. You can then show that outside of the horizon, these quantum fluctuations become classical. Okay, so the field amplitude and its conjugate momentum starts vanishing. The commutator of those two start vanishing outside of the horizon. So we can then compute at horizon crossing a power spectrum as a function of k of zeta fluctuations. That power spectrum is preserved throughout the evolution of this field. In particular, it's preserved through this uncertain period where we don't understand the physics very well. Inflation ends, you know, reheating couples the inflaton to other particles. A lot of messy details are happening here. But since these modes are far outside of the horizon, causality roughly forbids evolution of the modes quite independently of the physical details of what's happening here. Okay, but you're going to do it, of course. Yeah. So I'm going to do a standard Bunch Davis. So basically, at sufficiently early times, you can show that the expansion of the universe becomes more and more irrelevant by the equivalence principle, basically. So these field fluctuations behave as harmonic oscillators in flat space, essentially. And so then you just choose the preferred vacuum, minimal energy state of the harmonic oscillator in flat space as this ground state. But that's certainly the most subtle part of this entire quantization procedure, which I'm going to do next at the beginning of next time. And so recombination might occur sometime here, where this particular k-mode that I've drawn here was still outside of the horizon. So it's precisely the mode that looks as if it naively violates causality. There are other modes that have shorter wavelengths that might be inside of the horizon at that moment. They're less puzzling to us, although they still would have to be tuned in any alternative theory. So there, in general, is a spectrum of different wavelengths, of course. that will exit and enter the horizon at different times. And so only after these modes come back inside of the horizon, they start evolving, and then they source the CMB fluctuations, they source the formation of structure, and all the rest. Let's see. I don't think it's a good idea for me to start the canonical quantization and rush it. So that's the next thing I would wanted to do, is I want to actually go through this calculation of calculating these quantum zero fine fluctuations. But I think it's better if I start that fresh next time. We're going to define the ground state for each k mode individually. Yeah. So each, if you just look at this equation of motion, actually we can see it from here already. Yeah. If I go deep inside of the horizon, I can start dropping this friction term, and I just have a harmonic oscillator with a, you know, with a time-dependent frequency here. And so I'm just going to quantize this harmonic oscillator independently for each of the k modes, which then leads to the Bunch-Davis vacuum, which has other nice properties that it kind of, it's the most symmetric vacuum state that you could define in the sitter and so on.
Okay, if there are more questions, let's thank Dominic.